Thank you for coming to the first of the presentations that I'm doing here at the Hopkinton Council on Aging in 2017. My name is Arthur Bergeron. For those of you who haven't been here before, I'm an elder law attorney. I work at Myrick O'Connell. There are 60 of us at Myrick O'Connell, all doing different things, which allows me to do just elder law. This is one of the four presentations that I do every year, and every year I try the first presentation to do a 101, which is a collection of all of the things that you kind of need to know as a senior. I don't try to go in depth into any particular one, although I'm happy to take questions at the end. I use the other presentations later in the year to go into more depth. Specifically, there are a large set of proposed regulations changes right now being proposed by MassHealth, which will significantly affect the way in which and whether you can qualify for MassHealth if you are in a nursing home or at home. I had anticipated that by now those regulations would be passed. I think so did MassHealth. They proposed them back in November. There was a public hearing in December. They said they were going to be in effect February 1. Because of some of the public outcry regarding some of these proposed changes, though, apparently they're on hold. No one tells us exactly how long they're on hold for or whether they've evaporated. I think I will have a better sense of that when I do the next presentation here, which I think is in a couple of months. So in the meantime, this is Elder Law 101, and it deals with my friends Frank and Mary and their children, Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. You've all met them before, if you've been here before. And once again, especially this presentation is for a lot of folks who are at home and who kind of can't make this, but just need to know some of these kind of basics. So their goal is very simple. They want to live in their house until they die. They want to be buried in the backyard. And after they die, they want to leave all their assets to Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr., their three children. There are their assets. They own their home, which has a value of $300,000. He has an IRA of $150,000. They have an annuity worth $100,000. They have bank accounts worth $75,000 for a total of $625,000. He has income from Social Security of $1,500 and from a pension of $500 a month for a total of $2,000. She has income from Social Security of $750 a month. So all in, they're at about $2,750 a month. They're not rich, but they're not broke. They have a house with no mortgage. They're going to be okay in general, unless one of them needs nursing home care, and we'll talk about that way at the end. But in the meantime, they've got some questions. What are the documents that they absolutely have to have? Especially if they're younger, so they're not really worried about, at this point, about nursing home care and dealing with that, what do they have to have? Do they really have to have a will? We'll know, and we'll talk about that in a little while. What they really need to have are those three documents. They're very easy. They're cheap. Everybody should have them. Everybody should have them. They are a healthcare proxy, a MOLST form, and a power of attorney. I bet you know two out of three. Raise your hand if you know what a MOLST form is. That's zero. That's about the usual number that I hear from as far as the MOLST form. So we're going to talk about those. A healthcare proxy. The point of a healthcare proxy is to authorize someone to make medical decisions on your behalf if you're not capable of making medical decisions. I want to emphasize that because that's all that a healthcare proxy is for. And if a doctor later determines to so-called activate the healthcare proxy, what the doctor is doing is saying that you're no longer capable of making healthcare decisions. He's not saying you're incompetent. The reason why I mention that is that regularly nursing home staff, doctors, others, get this wrong. They think that because the healthcare proxy has been activated, so-called, that therefore the person who signed the healthcare proxy is now no longer able to do anything and no longer able to sign a new power of attorney, for example, or a will or a deed. But it may very well be that a person who is not capable of making a medical decision, and those are pretty complicated, is totally capable of saying, I want my daughter to handle my affairs for me, which is really a power of attorney, or I want to deed my house to my husband. You know, they get that. Or I have a will, and I want to make sure everything goes to my kids when I die. So it isn't that they've become incapable of that. You should just be aware of that, because a lot of folks in the medical profession are unaware of this, right? So to have a valid healthcare proxy in Massachusetts, and this varies by state, right, you need two witnesses. that the witnesses can be anyone, except that if they are working in the witnesses can be anyone. Medical decision, you're only authorizing these people to make medical decisions for you, and then only after your doctor has said you're incompetent. How about, you know, if I sign this and I give it to my daughter, can she put me in a nursing home? Well, the answer is, in theory, a nursing home, the decision to admit one to a nursing home is a medical decision. So one could say yes, except if you've given your daughter the healthcare proxy and she now brings you to the nursing home and you get to the entrance and you say, I don't want to be here, what the nursing home is supposed to send you back home. Because what you have done is, and there's a case on this that dealt with this issue, what you did by saying you don't want to be there is you revoked the healthcare proxy. And therefore, you shouldn't be admitted to that nursing home unless a court orders it, right? So, of course, that's good news if you're the old person that doesn't want to go. It's kind of bad news if you thought that because you had the healthcare proxy and Ma is really losing her grip that you could put her in the nursing home. I will tell you that in these situations, typically, the older person stays in the nursing home and it doesn't play out to this kind of, you know, dramatic result. But I just want you to be aware of that. Finally, as I mentioned, you can revoke your healthcare proxy at any time. And simply by refusing medical treatment, that acts as if you're refusing treatment that your proxy is saying that you should be having, that acts as a revocation of your proxy. Remember, it only applies to medical decisions. Regarding deeds, new powers of attorney, wills, it does not apply if the doctor says that you're not competent just to deal with medical decisions. Also, you should note about healthcare proxies that your proxy, by naming that person, you've authorized them to deal with your remains after you die. So that's of significance because many people assume that organ donations only happen if you've signed a little form or put it on your license or whatever saying that you want to make an organ donation if you die. That's not what the current law is. Your organ donation, your willingness to do it is presumed. Unless somebody after you die says otherwise. So you want to be aware of that, you know, and talk to your proxy about that. And if you're very concerned about it, even put that kind of information right into the proxy. Yep.
Regarding that, if you've made the choice, that's listed on your driver's license. So that's a legal document.
That's right.
Can your healthcare proxy administrator change that?
Can your healthcare proxy overrule the decision that you made on your license to be a donor? Yes. Yes, okay. We've done those. And what are the healthcare proxy kinds of decisions that are in the healthcare proxy? Well, there are a number that you want to be talking about. No, excuse me. Now, you know, it's just been a long day and I'm getting confused. Now let's talk about the MOLST form. The MOLST form, which many people kind of think blends into the healthcare proxy. The MOLST form are medical orders for life-sustaining treatment, MOLST, hence the name, the MOLST form, has replaced the so-called DNR, Do Not Resuscitate form, which the Department of Public Health encourages every person, but especially every senior, to do. You should understand, though, that the MOLST form is not, the significance of the MOLST form is not that you signed it. The significance is that your doctor signed it. It is a medical order from your doctor that says to the rest of the world, the EMTs and the nurses, et cetera, to the rest of the world, if you are in a bad way, that they are not supposed to do what they would normally do, which is try to make sure you don't die. So the MOLST form actually covers particular kinds of ways that might be bad, like you're not breathing, and the question is, do you want somebody to? Or excuse me. Or your heart has stopped. The question is, do you want the EMTs, all the folks, to try to make your heart start again? Now that process is a very painful process. It typically involves pushing through your ribs, often breaking them, trying to push down on your heart to try to get your heart to kind of go again. And the likelihood of survival for more than 30 days, I think the figure I heard, if you're over 70 years old, your likelihood of surviving that for more than 30 days is 5%. Your likelihood of surviving like being brought back for a moment, is like 25%. So the question is, do you want, when you're thinking about it and you're weighing it out, do you want everything done to make sure that you're going to live, despite the fact that chances are what you've actually done is you've caused your death to be incredibly painful, the last moments of your life. So you need to kind of weigh that out. Similarly with intubation. Intubation means dealing with the fact that you've stopped breathing by putting a pipe down your throat and pushing it into your lungs and trying to force some oxygen or air into your lungs so that you'll start breathing again. And you know, the question is, do you want that? Or if you're Frank and Mary and your goal was to die and be buried in the backyard, do you want to stay at home if you're dying as opposed to being sent to the hospital? So there's actually a place on the form that you can say, do not hospitalize. So you may want to talk to your doctor about this. The form requires the doctor's signature. Once you've done one, if you've done one, put it on the refrigerator. The reason why you put it on the refrigerator is that that's what the EMTs have been told is the one place they will look in the house if they get to the house and you're on the floor and they need to figure out what to do. That's the protocol. So if it's not on the refrigerator, they're not going to start looking in your drawers, you know, to look at this, and probably not even in your wallet. The refrigerator is the place, okay? And remember that your proxy, you're going back to the proxy, your healthcare proxy can make all decisions for you, including changing your mind for you when you're incapable of making a medical decision. The proxy can overrule the MOLST form at any time. So you really want your proxy to know what your intentions are regarding all of this. And if you've got a child who is going to be squeamish about doing the things you want to do, and often there is that tension, pick another child, you know, or find somebody else, right? Because this is your decision. These are your life decisions, right? We talked about that. If you haven't done the healthcare proxy, then the only way to get someone to make medical decisions for you is by getting a guardianship. Very expensive, time-consuming, all in the public. It's awful. You don't want to go there. Powers of attorney. Does a power of attorney need to be notarized? Well, actually, no. Not unless you're using it or the person who has the attorney is using it to record a deed for you or something else that has to be recorded in the registry of deeds. Does it have to be witnessed? Well, no. In some states it does, but in Massachusetts it does not. So why would you do all of that stuff? Well, the main reason, I typically don't use witnesses in my powers of attorney, but I always notarize them. And the main reason is because it makes them look really legal, right? So because the person who is deciding whether the power of attorney is valid is not a judge, right? But it's like the lady at the bank or the person at the insurance company that your son or daughter is trying to deal with some of these issues. And if the power of attorney is old, that's why we suggest they be less than 5 years old, or if it doesn't kind of look official, you know, this random people can be saying, well, I don't know if this is good. And now what are you going to do? You know, you're going to sue them because they're not taking the power of attorney? There's nothing you can do. So you want to really make it look official, which is, it has been my experience now, I've been practicing for over 40 years, just amazes me, that there's something about a document with a seal on it, a notary seal. People go, oh, that's a real legal document. It's notarized. So have it notarized. In the power of attorney, for reasons that I'll mention later on, you especially want to deal with this gifting and self-dealing issue. The law is that unless a power of attorney specifies that the person to whom you've given this power has the power to make gifts on your behalf, they can't. And unless they have the power to make gifts to themselves, they can't do that either. So that's really important if, for example, you've named your spouse as your attorney in your power of attorney, and now you're disabled or you're trying to qualify for MassHealth, and as part of the restructuring that I want to do to help you to get qualified for MassHealth, I want to shift all of your assets to your spouse so that I can get you down below $2,000 so you can qualify for MassHealth. But of course, your spouse at this point had a stroke or was in the nursing home or whatever, he can't sign anything anymore, right? Which means if you, as his attorney, can't sign anything for him, you're stuck. We can't get anything out of his name and into your name so we can qualify him for MassHealth unless we do a conservatorship, which is also incredibly expensive and takes a long time. So you want to make sure that you've dealt with those issues. Now, specifically regarding older powers of attorney, it has been my experience that I'll often see powers of attorney that contain a gifting power But that power of attorney was designed by somebody who is typically doing financial planning and not mass health related planning. So often there'll be a limitation in that power that says that you can't give away on behalf of the person who did the power of attorney over the federal estate tax amount, which I'm not, this isn't about federal estate tax or the federal gift tax amount. And this isn't about gift taxes, but the magic number now is $14,000 a year. So you don't want a power of attorney in that case, which limits you to only being able to give away up to $14,000 of that person's assets. Otherwise, we can't do the restructuring that we want. So in your power of attorney, you can name people jointly and severally if you want to. So you can actually name two people. You can name them jointly, which means that they both always have to sign for whatever on whatever decision needs to get made. So that's checks and balances, but it's a hassle. You can also name them jointly and severally. So you can name a couple of your kids jointly and severally. The legal consequence of that is that if one's not around, the other one can do it without showing that the first one, you know, resigned or anything. So that's often handy, especially now given the fact that so many kids aren't around, you know, or kind of far away. So powers of attorney. The alternative is conservatorship. We've talked about how bad that is. To understand about wills, you need to understand briefly about probate. So the purpose of the probate process. The purpose of the probate process is to figure out, especially regarding assets of yours that have a title to them, like your car or your house or your bank account. So some third party has to be involved to figure out who owns them after you die. So if you own something in your individual name, we can't figure out who owns them after you die unless there's a probate. Now, regarding who gets them, if you don't have a will, there is a statute that deals with that. It's called the Rules of Intestacy that explains who gets things after you die. And in Frank and Mary's case, if one of them dies, the rules of intestacy are, unless they'd been previously divorced, some other stuff, that the spouse gets everything, and that following that spouse, and if that spouse has died, then the kids get everything. So if Frank and Mary's estate plan was, if when I die, I want everything to go to my spouse, and after that, but if my spouse is dead, I want everything to go to my kids, well then, in that situation, they really don't need a will, right? Because the exact same thing would happen. Now, many people will say to me, oh, I have a will, and that way I can avoid probate. Well, no, that's not the case. The probate process applies to everybody whose assets they own in their own names at the time of death, and therefore we have to figure out who gets them, right? So you're not avoiding probate by having a will. The way you avoid probate is by making sure that none of your assets are in your individual names at the time that you die. So for example, in this case, Frank and Mary, they own their house jointly. Frank has an IRA. So those are unusual assets. The IRA, it looks like Frank owns it, but when he gets the bank statement, it always says like custodian for, that the bank is the custodian for him. Technically, the bank owns it, but the bank has certain obligations to pay him, like if he asks for the money, but then they have to do some tax reporting and some other stuff. So in that on that asset, like with life insurance policies, he names a death beneficiary. He probably has a death beneficiary on his annuity also. So those are assets which will pass directly to the beneficiary at death and don't go through probate. Bank accounts, they own their bank account jointly. So in that situation, if Frank dies, there will be no probate. Not because they have a will or anything, but just because none of their assets are held just in Frank's name. Tangible personal property kind of never comes up. The kids always just kind of divide it up. So the issue is always with property for which there is a title. If Mary then dies, though, and the assets are in her name, then there will be a probate because we need to figure out who becomes the owner of Mary's assets. So, But by the way, that's the situation. If Mary dies, the children will divide up the assets unless there is a prior marriage and there were kids by two marriages. If you've got one of the kind of a blended couple, then the answer is go talk to a lawyer because that at that point it gets complicated. You're going to need a will, right? Because the rules of intestacy aren't going to kind of take care of you in the way that you would expect, okay? So does Mary need a will, though, if Frank is dead and she simply wants to divide up the assets among the kids? Well, maybe not. There are these four reasons why she may. If one of her kids has creditor problems, or one of her kids is in a marriage that isn't so great, you know, and so maybe she's worried that if she leaves stuff to the daughter that, you know, there's going to be a divorce next month, and all of a sudden those assets are going to be considered to be part of the estate. Or if one of her children has a disability, so that she wants to make sure that she doesn't inadvertently, by leaving one of her kids' assets, disqualify them for a program like MassHealth or other programs that are means-tested, where you can't be on the program if you have too much in assets. In all of those cases, in the case of creditors, where you don't want to be leaving the assets to some creditor, right, instead of leaving it to your child, or possible divorce or disability, Mary may want to say that instead of leaving assets directly to her child or children, she's going to leave those assets instead in trust for the benefit of that child. And she can put that right in the will. She could name typically one of the other children as the trustees. And the rule is, as long as that beneficiary, the child for whom those assets are being held in trust, doesn't have the legal right to get a distribution out of the trust, no creditor can get to that money, no spouse can get to the money, and it's not a countable asset if that child needs to qualify for benefits. So in those situations, Mary may want to have a will that has those kinds of provisions. Finally, the house. Mary doesn't have a will. Then legally what happens is that upon her death, Peter, Paul, and Mary simply become the owners of the house. Boom, right? Which means if anything needs to happen from then on in regarding the house, like selling it or mortgaging it or allowing one of the kids to live there, right? Everybody has to agree. And if everybody can't agree, everybody gets to live there. It isn't like one child gets to live there and has to pay rent to the other. No, the rule, everybody gets to live in the house, right? And regarding a sale, everybody has to agree on the sale price or a rental. Everybody has to agree. And if they don't, well, then it's problematic how you deal with it. And then the only way that the house can get sold, that any of the three kids can force a sale of the house, is to do something called a petition to partition real estate and go to land court and have the land court basically appoint somebody to sell the house and give them title to the house so they can sell it and then figure out how the proceeds get distributed. Well, as you can imagine, that's a mess. I've gone through those. They typically take several years, and you end up eating a huge amount of all of the money on lawyers because now everybody's got to get a lawyer to try to figure out how to divide up the proceeds, okay? So in that situation, you may want to have a will in which you say that when you die, the house gets sold and the proceeds get distributed, as opposed to saying that when you die, they simply get the house, right? So that you can avoid that problem. Now, how can you avoid probate? Well, as I mentioned, you can avoid probate by making sure that when you die, no significant asset of yours is just in your name. One of the most common ways to do that is joint ownership. Make sure that somebody ideally the person you want to leave the asset to owns the property with you jointly with rights of survivorship. The reason for that is that legally, if two people or three people own something jointly, they each own 100% of the property. So when one person dies, that person's interest simply evaporates, leaving the other people as the owners of 100% of the property. So there's nothing then that needs to get probated. So for folks who have sold their home, and typically their assets are in cash accounts or accounts that have death beneficiaries, the only thing that triggers probate in those cases is the car. You want to make sure when you die that ideally you've got a car that's in joint names with somebody else. And even, you know, and people will say, but it's a crummy car. I'll say, yeah, but the problem, no matter how crummy it is, the problem is that when you die, the survivor can't sell it if the survivor doesn't own all the car. And then the survivor is going to need to go to some kind of probate process, probably a fairly inexpensive one, but it's just a hassle, in order to get title to the car to be able to sell it. So try to deal with the car. Another possibility is a life estate, right? And this is especially regarding real estate, and you've probably heard that term, that folks who want to make sure that their house goes to their kids after they die will keep a so-called life estate in the property, that is, total ownership as long as they're alive, but convey to the children a remainder interest, that is, the interest in the property after they die, so that upon their death, their interest, their life estate evaporates, leaving the kids as the sole owners. This is often a very efficient estate. This can be a very efficient estate planning tool for tax purposes, if you do it that way. For estate tax purposes and for capital gains purposes, you still own, because you still own this interest, upon your death, the so-called tax basis in the house still jumps to the date of death value, so your kids still get to sell it when they sell it, capital gains tax-free, which is the same as if you just owned it individually. But there's no probate involved. So that there are some positives to doing this. A couple of the negatives I'll just mention. I'll give you two cases. One, I had a situation where these folks had transferred their interests in their house to their kids and kept a life estate. And many years later, 10 or 15 years later, wanted to sell their house. Because they'd been living in the house for years, but now they just wanted to sell it and cash in and move. They called me because two of the kids in that situation, they wanted their kids to deed their interest back to the parents so the parents could then turn around and sell the house. And by the way, in that situation, if they want to sell the house, they have to own the house totally for 2 years. Right. The rule is regarding you're getting your capital gains exemption when you go to sell your real estate that you have to have been living in the house and owned it for two of the previous 5 years. It doesn't count if you only had a life estate and you would transfer that remainder interest to your kids. So if you then want to sell the house, they need to transfer their remainder interest back to you, and then you need to wait 2 years and then sell the house if you want the capital gains exemption. But anyway, in this case, the issue was, one of the kids wouldn't transfer his remainder interest back to the parents. And so they said, well, what can we do? And I said, there's nothing you can do. There's just nothing you can do. You can't force them to transfer this interest back. You could file one of those petitions to partition real estate and have the court order the sale of the house. But then all that you're entitled to as the older people is the piece of the value that is attributable to the life estate, which in this case, these people were about 80 years old. So the life estate was worth about 15% of the value of the property. And so they were really stuck because they wanted to sell their house because, among other things, they lived on Martha's Vineyard. They wanted to cash out. That was their big asset. So they said, well, could we take a reverse mortgage? And I said, yes, but all the kids have to sign it because all the kids own the remainder interest in the property. And of course, this one child wouldn't sign. So that's case one. Case two was I got a call from a lady who had, once again, she had transferred the remainder interest to her son. She had only one child. She kept the life estate many years later. She called. She said, just wanted to make sure everything's fine because her son just got served with divorce papers by his wife. And she said, I just wanted to see if that's a problem. And I said, well, yes, that is a problem because your son owns the remainder interest. And using the tax table that the IRS has in computing the value of the percentage value of the remainder interest versus the life estate, once again, this woman was 75 or 80 years old, so her interest was only worth about 20%, which would mean in this case that the son's interest was worth about 80%. This house, once again, was on Martha's Vineyard, so it was worth about $600,000. Wasn't a real big house, but it was Martha's Vineyard. So 80% of $600,000 was going to be in play in that divorce. So there are some reasons to not do it, but it is the cheapest and easiest way to avoid probate. By the way, this is also something that the life estate and the joint ownership that you really want to think about if somebody's about to die. If people are deteriorating and close to death and you have an estate plan that, you know, my will and things are going to go to this one and that one, well, if you can deal with it before you die by keeping yourself a life estate but giving people remainder interest or putting people on your bank accounts and stuff jointly, you may be able to avoid probate altogether. I actually have a couple of those cases right now where we're trying to just reshuffle the assets relatively soon because people are going to be dying maybe in a month or 2 months.
Just to be clear in my own mind, a life estate could be compared to a deed.
A deed transfers a life estate. You use a deed in order to give somebody a life estate, to give somebody a remaining
interest. To get the life estate back, they have to.
But in order to get the life estate back, they would have to deed their interest back to you and have it recorded in the registry of deeds. Okay. Finally, stuff in the house. You don't really need to do a lot about dealing with stuff in the house, right? The stuff in the house, you know, the dishes that go to this one and the silverware that go to that one. Typically, the kids just figure that out. If you're concerned that they're not going to, then actually do a list. Do a list for them and say, here are my desires regarding where things are going to go. That list, unless you have a will, is not going to be legally binding. But once again, I've been practicing for 40 years. I've never had this issue happen regarding fights over tangible personal property. So typically, if the issue is probate avoidance, don't worry about it. Make sure you deal with the car, the bank accounts, the house, okay? Or you could use a revocable trust. If Mary was concerned about possibly these arguments among the kids or keeping control of the property so that if she later needs to sell it, she can. She doesn't have to worry about capital gains issues. She can create a revocable and amendable trust. Name herself as the trustee for the benefit of herself and her kids, but name a successor trustee, another one of the kids, and say, when I die, put it right in the trust, when I die, automatically this other person becomes the trustee. If that happens and she's holding the house in trust or bank accounts in trust, upon her death, the new trustee immediately steps in and can immediately deal with the property and sell it and do whatever they want to do it. By the way, that trust, for most purposes, it leaves Mary still owning the asset. For tax purposes, that is a so-called grantor taxable trust, so that if she owns the house as the trustee of that trust and then sells it, she still gets her capital gains exemption, her $250,000 capital gains exemption, as if she owned it. Similarly, for MassHealth purposes, if she wants to qualify for MassHealth later on and needs to show that she has less than $2,000 in countable assets, these assets are still going to be counted as hers because she still owns them, okay? Now, MassHealth 101. Yes, ma'am.
Should an IRA be signed by two people?
As I mentioned, is actually owned technically by a third party. And you can simply instruct that third party where that money is going to go after you die. It's like a life insurance policy. Just make sure you have a death beneficiary. And make sure the death beneficiary is alive. Because if the death beneficiary is dead, then the asset upon your death goes into your estate. Okay, I've had that situation where I had a woman divorced her husband, got rid of him as a death beneficiary, but didn't name anybody else. She didn't have any kids, and then died, had a heart attack on the train going into Boston, went to State Street Bank. And so the legal effect of that was that everything, and she didn't have a will, so everything went to her parents, which in this case was her father, who was 92, who lived in Seattle and who was heading to a nursing home. So she basically made her father ineligible for getting the nursing home care because he ended up inheriting $300,000 of this IRA. Okay, so you want to make sure the beneficiary isn't dead. So MassHealth 101. Back to Frank and Mary. There are their assets, the house, the IRA, the annuity, the bank accounts. And the question is, if Mary needs to qualify for MassHealth because she needs nursing home care, and she knows that Medicare won't pay more than 100 days worth of nursing home care, and she knows that if she qualifies for MassHealth, MassHealth will pay the difference between her income, which was, remember, was $750 a month, and whatever the nursing home bill is. So she really wants to qualify for MassHealth. Now, if she wants to qualify and Frank is still alive, then all I have to do is shift all of the assets to Frank and then have Frank purchase an annuity. Because while Mary cannot have more than $2,000 in countable assets, Frank can own the home itself as long as it has an equity of less than $850,000. Can have other cash or cash equivalent assets. I realize I didn't change this number. This number is now $120,220, not $119,220. Can have cash or cash equivalent assets equal to $120,220. And can have unlimited income. So all Mary has to do at this point is shift all of her assets to Frank, and then have Frank go buy an annuity. An annuity is an income stream, a contract that you make with an insurance company. You give them money, they promise to pay it back to you with some interest. As long as that annuity calls for equal monthly payments over a term that is shorter than Frank's actuarial life expectancy, then the purchase of that annuity in any amount is a legitimate conversion from a countable asset to a non-countable income stream. So as long as Frank owns the house, which has an equity that's below the magic number, keeps, say, $100,000, takes the other money. Remember, they had another $325,000 in other assets. So say he keeps $100,000, takes the rest of it, and buys an annuity. As long as that annuity calls for equal monthly payments over a term that is shorter than his actuarial life expectancy, the purchase of that annuity is a legitimate conversion from an asset to an income stream, and the day after he buys the annuity, she can qualify for MassHealth. Now, under current law, I think this may be the next slide. Yes, under current law, the kids can be the beneficiaries of that annuity. So if Frank, if Mary's in the nursing home or has died but had been in there on MassHealth, and Frank dies, and there are still remaining payments to be made to Frank, those payments he can simply name as his death beneficiaries, his other kids. MassHealth has no claim on that money. One of the proposed regulation changes, which is pending, and which I'm going to talk more about when I come back probably in May, would change that rule and would make MassHealth the first beneficiary, even though Frank had never gone on MassHealth. Right? It would make them the first beneficiary in order to pay back any amounts that they had paid on Mary's behalf while Mary was in the nursing home. As I said, that is pending. Stay tuned. Finally, I just want to go back to one other thing. The other thing that Frank would want to do after all the assets had been changed to Frank, moved to Frank, is to change his will. Because what he would want to say in his will, because his current will says everything goes to Mary. Remember, because their goal was one dies, everything goes to the other. He would want to have in his will, he would want to specify that everything that was going to go to Mary instead is going to go in trust for Mary's benefit. And as long as he does that, whatever assets he owns when he dies that go through probate and therefore pass according to the terms of this will, which has this testamentary trust in it, those assets will all be safe. Whether Mary is already in a nursing home and qualified for MassHealth, whether she's still at home and maybe needs to qualify later on, those assets are always going to be safe. Yes, ma'am. Why does Frank have to buy an annuity if it's Mary that's going into the nursing home? That's a very good question, because if Mary bought the annuity, right, because she's now in the nursing home, remember, once she is qualified for MassHealth, all of her income goes to the nursing home, and then MassHealth pays the difference between that income and whatever the nursing home cost is. But if Mary has bought the annuity, then those monthly payments are coming to Mary, which means they're part of her income, which means they get added to the amount that goes to the nursing home every month, right? And then MassHealth pays the rest. Also, if Mary has bought the annuity, even under current law, following Mary's death, MassHealth has a lien on all of those assets, a lien on all of the remaining annuity payments. Under current law, if it's your annuity, then and you die and there were remaining payments, MassHealth has to have a claim on those payments, right? Right now, if it's Frank's annuity, then regarding Mary's MassHealth qualification, MassHealth has no interest.
But why does anyone buy an annuity? What does the annuity have to do with Mary at all?
Why does anyone buy an annuity? The reason why you're buying the annuity, the reason why Frank is buying the annuity is because there is a MassHealth rule that the spouse at home cannot have more than a given amount of assets. And that number right now is $120,220. So he's buying a big enough annuity to get his remaining assets below that magic number. See how that works? Great, okay. So that's that, and that's that. So many times people are coming to talk to me and they say, well, I really want to try to do this kind of protection of assets for the benefit of my spouse, but I really want to avoid probate. You can't do both of those at the same time. The only way that Frank can make sure that upon his death, the assets that would have gone to Mary or somebody else are going to be protected is by having a will and having those assets go through probate. Okay? Frank and Mary's asset protection plan, therefore, we talked about these. They want to have those wills with asset protection provisions. So when people are coming into me and they're talking to me in general, these are typically folks that are over 70. My median client age is 74. You get to a certain age where the cloud of possible nursing home care gets to overwhelming everything else. So at 65, that's not as much an issue. At 85, it's really an issue. And then somewhere in between, the question is, when do you start losing sleep over it? If you're worried about it, then this is what people would typically do. Both people would do wills with these asset protection provisions, saying if I die, everything is going to be safe for the benefit of my spouse. They're both going to execute powers of attorney so that if one of them gets sick and you want to get shift assets to that person before they die, you know that there's a power of attorney around that can handle all of that. And then some folks, if one spouse feels, if based on family history or based on age or whatever, one spouse feels that there's really a significantly greater chance that that spouse is going to die early or die suddenly, then sometimes folks will actually shift assets to that spouse right away, especially if there's a big history of heart attack and people are just worried about that, okay? Now, once again, what happens if Frank dies and just Mary is alive and now Mary has inherited all the assets and she's trying to figure out what to do? Remember, those were their assets? Mary's asset protection plan at this point is much more difficult if she wants to protect it as far as MassHealth is concerned. She needs to give her assets away and wait 5 years. When you hear about the famous 5-year look-back period regarding protecting your assets, regarding MassHealth, this is when it applies. After one spouse has died, when the second spouse is trying to deal with these assets. One common way is regarding the house, which is typically the biggest asset, is to give the house away and retain a life estate, either to the kids, and we talked about that earlier, or to an irrevocable trust, naming one of the children as the trustee for the benefit of the others, right? And you can transfer that interest in the house to the kids. You could also transfer other assets either to the kids individually or to this irrevocable trust. You can actually have, this is legally valid, and has actually one of our attorneys, Lisa Neely, at our firm, actually won this case last summer. She was arguing it, and the decision came last fall. That said that if you have an irrevocable trust and your kids are named as the beneficiaries, and your kids are named as the trustees or one of them, even though the kids have the right regarding any assets that are in trust to basically give them to themselves as beneficiaries and then turn around and give them back to you as the older person, because that's what you're always hoping if you're Mary and you're trying to protect your assets for MassHealth purposes, you're transferring it to the kids and you're hoping that they're going to give them back to you if you need them, right? But you can't have them legally obligated to give them back to you, otherwise you'd still be in control of the assets. But even the trust which has that form to it and which allows kids to give assets back to themselves and turn around and give it back to you has been determined to be valid. And once assets have been transferred to the trustee of that trust and you've waited 5 years, those assets are safe. That asset protection plan, by the way, as far as Mary is concerned, can avoid both probate and protect the assets. Because once the assets are in trust, those assets are not going to have to go through the probate process after Mary dies. We talked about that. One other thing, and this is another one of the issues that I'm going to talk about more when I come back, once we know whether or not this rule has changed. There are some tools that Mary would have available to her, even if she owned all those assets and wanted to qualify for MassHealth because she was heading into a nursing home. And these tools are not meant to eliminate her nursing home bill, but rather to reduce it. And the reason why no matter what, you always want to qualify for MassHealth is that if Mary is in a nursing home right now on private pay, remember her income is $750 a month, right, from Social Security. So if she's in a nursing home right now on private pay, that nursing home bill probably is going to be around $12,000 a month. Now, just so that the math is easier, let's pretend that the bill is actually $12,750 a month. So Mary, while she's in that nursing home on private pay, her income is $750. Her burn rate, the rate at which her money is going to shrink, her savings are going to shrink while she's in that nursing home, is $12,000 a month, right? Because her income is $750 and the bill is $12,750. If she qualifies for MassHealth, once she's qualified for MassHealth, the MassHealth rate for the same bed in the same nursing home is going to be around $7,000 a month. I'm going to round that for math purposes and say that it was $7,750. So what Mary has done in that case by going from MassHealth, from being on private pay to going on MassHealth, is she substantially reduced her burn rate, the amount by which her savings are going to be being spent. Because at $7,750, her income is 7,000, or excuse me, her regular income is 750. She's saving that about She is saving $7,000, or she, excuse me, thank you. The amount that she will have to pay back, assuming that she has qualified for MassHealth by putting assets in places where MassHealth has a lien on them, when she dies, she's going to have to pay MassHealth back the difference between $7,750 a month and her income of $750 a month, or $7,000. She's going to be paying them back at the rate of $7,000 a month, right? She will have saved at that point the difference between that burn rate, $7,000 a month, and the other burn rate that we were talking about of $12,000 a month. That number is a mistake. That should be a savings of about $5,000 a month, right? So there always is an incentive for Mary to qualify for MassHealth. Now, currently, she has two ways of doing that. One is by putting money into a so-called D4C pooled trust. These are trusts that are run by nonprofits. The money can be used to benefit Mary in any way while she's alive, to supplement her care, but don't have to be used on nursing home care. MassHealth has a claim against that money following her death. But remember, the claim is only regarding the amount that they paid to the nursing home, which was based on this lower nursing home rate. Another thing that she can do is she can buy an annuity with her money and have these monthly payments. Now, we were talking about the fact that if she buys an annuity, then those monthly income payments are going to have to go to the nursing home. Except the total bill to the nursing home, as a result of the fact that she's on MassHealth, instead of being like $12,000 a month, is only going to be about $7,000 a month. So the amount that she's going to actually be paying to the nursing home is still going to be this much lower number. Now, the new regulations, and we're going to talk about that in a couple months, are going to really have a significant effect on both of those. First, they're going to make any transfer that's transferred to a D4C subject to the so-called five-year look-back period, which makes is going to make it useless if Mary is needing to go into the nursing home and hasn't done prior planning. Secondly, that they're going to say that the annuity that is being purchased has to be a commercial annuity. If commercial annuities right now cannot be purchased if they're shorter than 4 years, which means if Mary is 90 years old or over, which means that for life expectancy purposes, her life expectancy is below 4 years, the annuity route is no longer going to be available. So it's now going to be much harder for a single person to qualify for MassHealth unless they've restructured their assets and waited the 5 years. Okay? That's it. If you're just dying to see this again because I went too fast, or you've got any friends that want to see it, Frank and Mary have their own YouTube channel, and that's it. You can watch this show or any others. Any questions? Any questions? Yes, ma'am. What does MOLST stand for? MOLST. Medical Orders for Life-Sustaining Treatment. Medical Orders for Life-Sustaining Treatment. MOLST. Your doctors have these forms. And Medicare has actually changed their rules, their payment rules, and will pay you or will pay the doctor to have this kind of conversation with you regarding your MOLST form. That didn't used to be the case, and so doctors were kind of, you know, they were happy to do it, but not really happy because they weren't getting paid. Whereas now you can actually have that conversation with them about these very important decisions. Any other questions? If not, I'm glad to take any questions afterwards. Thank you very much for coming, and I'll see you in a couple of months, and we're going to talk specifically about qualifying for MassHealth and, if it's changed, how the rules for qualifying for MassHealth have changed as a result. Thank you very much.